Alright, so what we are going to do in this lecture and the next is, you know, try to look at the Zariski topology, but not in terms of closed sets but in terms of open sets. See, if you recall that any topology on a topological space is specified by either giving a collection of subsets which called closed sets which satisfy the axioms for closed sets for a topology, or equivalently it is given by a collection of subsets called open sets which satisfy the axioms for open sets required of a topology. And you know the axioms for closed sets and the axioms of open sets are just they are equivalent to one another by using properties of taking the complement of a set in a larger set, so De Morgan's laws for example. So usually when we do classical analysis or topology, for example if you study Euclidean space, n dimensional real space, then the topology is given only by using open sets, and the open sets are given by thought to be given by unions of, you know, open disks or open balls, okay, which turn out to be open intervals if you are in one dimension. Of course if it is 2 dimension then these are open disks and so on, but so the approach is by specifying open sets. But in the Zariski topology our approach has been by specifying closed sets, okay, called the algebraic sets, and these closed sets were given by the sets of common zeros of a bunch of polynomials in the right number of variables, okay. The number of variables should be equal to the number of copies of the field that you are taking, okay. Now what I want to do is to now shift the focus and get into study of open sets, okay, in the Zariski topology. So so what we have is so open sets in the Zariski topology. So this is what we want to get an idea about, okay. So so you know K of course is an algebraically closed field, and if you want, as usual you can think of K to be the set of complex numbers, field of complex numbers which is algebraically closed, and then you are looking at An K. This is just Kn with the Zariski topology, and of course the Zariski topology comes by looking at the polynomial ring in n variables and looking at common zero loci of a bunch of polynomials, and calling that common zero locus that particular subset of An as a closed subset, and then taking all possible subsets like that to be closed sets, and that's how you get the Zariski topology. Okay. Now, of course, we have defined what a variety is. A closed subvariety of affine space, okay, is supposed to be, by definition, a closed subset which is irreducible, right? We have done that. So now, I start with an open set here and see how it looks like. So let U inside AN be an open set. Okay. So by of course assume that U is non-empty. Okay, and also if you that U is not the full space, which are both open, of course. Okay, because the null set is closed, the full space, which is its complement, is open, and since the full space is closed, the null set, which is its complement, is open. So these two are both open sets. They are the trivial open sets. Okay, but you are looking at a non-trivial open set, a proper non-empty proper open subset. Okay, and of course, what you must understand is you must remember that any such open set U is very special, in the sense that topologically it is dense, okay, and it is also irreducible as a topological space. So that's because we I've told you that the irreducibility of a topological space forces that every non-empty open subset of that topological space continues to be irreducible and also is dense. Okay, and since AN itself is irreducible, okay, because it corresponds to the zero ideal, okay, which is prime, and the zero ideal in the polynomial ring is prime because the polynomial ring is an integral domain. Okay, so AN corresponds to the whole affine space, corresponds to the prime ideal, namely the zero ideal. Therefore, it is irreducible. We proved that a closed subset and in AN is irreducible if and only if the ideal that it corresponds to, okay, namely the ideal of functions that vanish on that closed subset, is actually a prime ideal. Okay, that's the translation of irreducibility, which is a geometric property, into the ring theoretic property of primeness in the polynomial ring. Okay, so AN is a is irreducible, and therefore any non-empty open set is both irreducible and dense. Okay, so recall that U is irreducible and dense. So this is something very special. Okay, doesn't happen, for example, in the usual topology. Okay, for example, if you take the topology of the real line given by open sets, given by open intervals, and or if you take the topology of the plane R2, two copies of R, the real plane, and give the topology to be given by open sets which are unions of open disks, then you can see that a non-empty open set need not be it need not be irreducible, it need not be dense. Okay, but this is very special for the Zariski topology. Now the complement of U, which is AN minus U, is a closed set, that is by definition. And and what is a closed set for the Zariski topology? It is of the form Z of I, where I is an ideal in the polynomial. And mind you, this ideal cannot be the unit ideal, okay, because if this is the unit ideal, then the zero set of that will be the null set, and then the complement of U will be the null set, and that will mean that U is the full space, which is not the case. And mind you, this ideal cannot be the zero ideal also, because if it is a zero ideal, then the zero set of the zero ideal is the full space, and that means that the complement of U in the full space is the full space, and that will force the set U, open set U, to be the null set. So our assumptions tell you that I is a proper ideal which is not zero. Okay, I should say I is a proper ideal not equal to 0. Now, now you see. Now let's go back and look at it carefully. I mean, let's go back and recall the fact that this ideal has to be finitely generated. You see, we have Hilbert's basis theorem, which says that if R is a commutative ring with one which is noetherian, then any polynomial ring in finitely many variables over R is also noetherian. Okay, which means that, and the noetherian property, one of the definitions of the noetherian property is that every ideal is finitely generated. Therefore, a field K is always noetherian because it contains only two ideals, namely the full field as the unit ideal and the zero ideal. Therefore, a field is always noetherian, and therefore a polynomial ring in finitely many variables over a field is also a noetherian ring. Okay, that is, this is because of Hilbert's basis theorem or Emmy Noether's theorem, and therefore this ideal I is finitely generated. Okay, so let I be generated by f1 etc up to fm. Okay, so let I be have finitely many generators f1 through fm. Okay, then what is z of I? Then z of I is going to be just z of f1 through fm, and that is which is actually equal to, you know, intersection I equal to 1 to m z of fi. Okay, so the z of I is the set of points in the affine space which are common zeros for each of the polynomials fi. Okay, I running through 1 to m, and the common zero locus is just gotten by taking the zero locus of each of these sets and intersecting. Okay, now what does this tell you about u? So what will u be? U will be the complement of zi, so it will be the complement of this. And by de Morgan's laws, this is the union I equal to 1 to m of a and k minus z of fi. Okay, so you get this this expression which expresses any non-empty non-trivial open sets set as a union of open sets of this type, but the open sets of this type are special. In fact, they are the building blocks for the Zariski topology for the open sets. Mind you, Z of Fi is a hypersurface. Okay, it's essentially a hypersurface because it is defined by a single equation. It is defined by a single equation. Of course, if you assume that say Fi is actually irreducible, okay, then Z of Fi is a hypersurface. Okay, it's defined by a single equation. And what this is the complement of a hypersurface. Okay, this is the complement of a hypersurface. What is this locus? This is the locus where the particular function Fi does not vanish. It is the complement of the locus where Fi vanishes. Z of Fi is a locus of points where Fi vanishes, and this is the complement of that locus. Okay, and so it's a complement. If for example the Fi's are irreducible, then this is actually a complement of a hypersurface, the hypersurface defined by Fi, and these sets are very special. They are called they will turn out to be the basic open sets. Okay, so a set of the form an minus z of g is called a basic open set and is denoted by d of g. So this is the notation, d of g is the locus where g does not vanish. It is a complement of z of g, which is the locus where g vanishes. Okay, and such sets dg are called basic open sets. Now what we have just seen above is tells you that any open set, any non-trivial open set is a finite union of basic open sets, okay. So any open set is a finite union of such basic open sets, okay. Now you see there is a there is if you have gone through a first course in topology, there is a statement there is a notion called what is meant by a basic a collection of basic open sets. A collection of subsets of a topological space are is called a collection of basic open sets if this is a collection of open sets such that any other open set can be written as union of open sets in this collection. So the condition for a collection of subsets to be basic open sets is that they should be a collection of open sets, and any open set should be written as union of such basic open sets. And you can see that in that sense also any open set is writable as a union. In fact it's a finite union, we get more, any open set is in fact not just a union of basic open sets but it is a finite union of basic open sets, okay. And the other beautiful thing is if you take if you take the intersection of basic open sets, okay, that will also continue to be if you take finitely many basic open sets and take their intersection, that will continue to be a basic open set, okay. So note also that D of G1 intersection D of Gm, or if you want let me not use the same m, I can it can be something else, Gr is actually D of G1 product Gr, okay. This is quite clear because you see the D of taking the intersection of all the D of Gi's is trying to look at those points where none of the Gi's vanish, and none of the Gi's vanish at a point if and only if the product does not vanish at that point, okay. So you see these basic open sets have the property that you take finitely many of them and intersect them, the resultant the resulting subset is again a basic open subset of the same type, okay. They are closed under finite intersections and their finite unions give you all possible open sets, okay. So this justifies the terminology basic open set from the topological point of view, okay. So what all this tells you is that the open sets for the Zariski topology are built up by simply taking finite unions of basic open sets, where basic open sets are of this form. The basic open set is just given by the locus of non-vanishing of a single polynomial, okay. Fine. Now that's not the that's just the beginning of the story. In fact the whole philosophy in the most sophisticated form of algebraic geometry is that not only do these basic open sets define the most sophisticated possible object called a scheme in algebraic geometry, okay, but the fact is even the functions are built by looking at the functions on such small pieces. So you see the by now I think you should have noticed that our focus has started shifting to looking into rings of functions, okay. See the last lectures what we did was we assigned to every affine variety its coordinate ring, the affine coordinate ring of functions, which is simply the polynomial ring which is a ring of functions on the affine space in which the closed subvariety sits, divided by the prime ideal given by the ideal of vanishing of that of that irreducibly closed subset, okay. So this is what we called as the affine coordinate ring of a of an affine variety, okay. And I told you that I gave you an indication in the last couple of lectures that the association of a variety to its affine coordinate ring is a equivalence of categories, it can also be thought of as a bijection, okay. So the set of isomorphism classes of varieties is bijective to the set of isomorphism classes of affine coordinate rings, okay. And the affine coordinate rings are of course given by abstractly they are defined as finitely generated K algebras which are integral domains, okay. So the moral of the story is I told you that you know the whole affine variety is completely controlled by its ring of functions, which is in line with the statement of Felix Klein that this geometry of the space is controlled by the functions on the space. So the whole point about algebraic geometry in going from the geometric side to the commutative algebra side is to completely is to associate to the space its ring of functions, okay. So the fact is that not only do these basic open sets form the building blocks of any open sets, but also that the very functions on your space they also come by gluing together or putting together, okay. Just like you put these sets together to get an open set, the fact is to get a function on that open set you will have to put together functions on the sets like this which you put together to get that open set, okay. So the fact is these are not just basic open sets from the in the topological sense, they are basic open sets even in the function theoretic sense, even their functions on these will dictate the functions on the union, okay. So the whole so what I'm trying to tell you is that I'm just trying to tell you that it's very important to look at, if you want to study functions on open sets, okay, then you should study functions on basic open sets, okay. That's what I'm trying to tell you. And why do you look at functions on open sets? Because you'll have to look at functions if you want to go to the commutative algebra side. I mean, all this time we were looking at functions on irreducible closed subsets, which are subvarieties, and the functions where the ring of functions where the corresponding affine coordinate rings, which are finitely generated K algebras, which were integral domains, okay. Now, if you try to do that to open sets, the first step you have to start with is try to understand what are the functions on a set like this, a basic open set like this, okay. So, to that, so to get into that, let me make a definition. Definition. Okay. So definition. The ring of functions on DG is namely denoted A of DG is defined to be the polynomial ring, which is the ring of functions on the ambient affine space in which you are considering D of G, localized at G. So look at this definition, okay. The definition says that the coordinate ring, the affine coordinate ring, the coordinate ring of functions is this polynomial ring localized at G, okay. And if you remember, if you go back and go back to commutative algebra, what this means is this is as a set, this consists of equivalence classes of the form F by G, where F is a polynomial in those many variables, and maybe I'll have a power of G, and M is well greater than or equal to 0. And of course, this equivalence class is I put a square bracket. The square bracket denotes equivalence class, and you know F by G power m, the equivalence class is equal to let me say H by G power L, if and only if there exists T such that g power t into g power l f minus g power m h is equal to 0, that is g power l f should be equal to g power m h. Okay. And of course, so in all these things I must remind you that you, when you localize at a single element in commutative algebra, it means that you are taking the multiplicative subset to be the set containing the powers of this element along with the element 1. Okay. So, and then it is also important to make sure that the element is not nilpotent. Okay. The multiplicative subset should not contain 0, and if the multiplicative subset is going to contain powers of g and 1, and 1 is being thought of as 0th power of g if you want, okay, then no power of g should vanish. And the fact is no power of g will vanish, because the ring here is an integral domain, it has no 0 devices, in particular it is reduced, it has no nilpotents. So the condition that g is not nilpotent is not necessary, it is automatic. Okay. So well, so leave alone this probably not so nice looking bunch of equations. Basically what it says is the set of functions on this locus where g does not vanish is just given by taking the usual polynomial functions and multiplying them with powers of g inverted. Okay. So this f by g power m can be thought of as f into 1 by g power m, which is f into g power m inverted. Okay. And that is a very sensible definition, because you see on this locus g does not vanish. Okay. Therefore reciprocal of g makes sense. So 1 by g on this locus, if you evaluate 1 by g, it is going to give you a non-zero scalar. So 1 by g is certainly a valid function where g does not vanish. I mean this is very this is a very standard thing that we come across always. If you, whenever a function is non-zero, then the reciprocal of the function is also a valid function with the same properties as the original function. For example, if a function is continuous, then if wherever it is not 0, the reciprocal of that function makes sense and that is also continuous. Similarly, if a function is holomorphic where the function is non-zero, the reciprocal of that function also becomes holomorphic. If a function is differentiable and if you look at the points where it is non-zero, okay, of course you always assume the points where it is non-zero is an open set, which will be true, because where the function, the points where the function vanishes will always be a closed set, because the functions will be continuous basically. And if you have a function with a certain property, then at the locus, open locus where the function does not vanish, the reciprocal of the function will also have the same property. So you should expect that 1 by g should be good enough. Only thing is it is not a polynomial, but it is a reciprocal of a polynomial. And then you see, therefore the functions on this basic open set are given by actually rational functions. Rational function is a quotient of 2 polynomials. The point is that the denominator polynomial is always some power of g. Of course it may be a honest polynomial, m can be 0, okay, or it could have powers of g in the denominator. Okay. Now this is the definition. Now what we need to do is I need to convince you that I need to convince you about 2 things. I need to convince you about that this definition is correct in by looking at it in another way. And that involves trying to tell you that this d of g, which is an open subset of an, okay, is actually also an affine variety. There is another avatar of this d of g which makes it an affine variety. It in fact becomes a closed sub variety of an plus 1. Okay. And this fact is you would have already encountered in commutative algebra when you looked at properties of localization. So you know, so the So the fact is A of d of g is itself an affine variety. This is a geometric fact, okay. I'll explain why that is correct, okay. And this is a geometric fact. The corresponding fact in commutative algebra is that. So let me write that. The corresponding fact in terms of commutative algebra is k of x1 etc. Xn localized at g is actually equal to, or maybe so let me write it here, let me rub that out, k x1 through xn localized at g, localization is actually equal to k x1 through xn, then add one more extra variable y modulo gy minus 1. This is the, so the fact that the these basic open sets are actually affine varieties, okay. Affine varieties means they must be closed subsets of affine space, irreducibly closed subsets of affine space. What you must understand is they are in the affine space in which you have started considering them, they are not closed, they are open, mind you. D of g is being considered in An, and in An d of g is an open set, it's a non-trivial open set, okay. So it cannot, it's not a, it can't be a closed set, because you know it's irreducible. So if it is closed, then it has to be the whole space, okay. So because it's if it's closed, it's also dense. So it has to be equal to, if it is closed, it has to be equal to its closure, and its closure has to be the whole space. So it will have to be equal to the whole space. So if you consider d of g in An, it's certainly a pakka open set. It's not a closed set. But the fact is that in a higher dimensional affine space, namely An plus 1, it sits as a closed subset. Okay. So and this is this geometric fact and the corresponding commutative algebraic factor. Related, as we will see, and the fact is that in that bigger affine space, this is the affine coordinate ring of that subset, which is the which is given by the coordinate ring of the full space divided by the ideal, the prime ideal that corresponds to that subset, that closed subset. So let me explain this. So what you do is, let's try to understand this. So here is a geometric statement, here is the corresponding statement in algebraic terms, and of course when I write here, maybe I should say isomorphic, okay. This is an isomorphism as k algebras, if you want, okay. So I have written equal to, but actually it's strictly speaking I should say they are isomorphic to each other, okay. And of course that isomorphism comes because of universal properties. The isomorphism in one direction, the isomorphism consists of two homomorphisms which turn out to be inverses of each other. The homomorphism from this side comes because of the universal property of localization. The homomorphism from this side comes because of the universal property of the polynomial ring, okay. So that's how that isomorphism comes. So let me do the following thing. So what you do is, so here is let me draw a diagram. It's not a very nice diagram, but anyway let me draw it. So here is my An, and in An in the space An, which will have several coordinates, several dimensions, but I am drawing something like a three-dimensional thing, and then g, the locus of g will correspond to hypersurface, So this is z of g. Okay. So I am just drawing a diagram that will help you to think, but it is not accurately correct. And it is the complement of z of g which is d of g. It is everything outside the hypersurface. Okay. Now what you do is you take, and you see here here the ring of functions is a of a n k, which is k of x1 through xn, and g is of course is a non-constant polynomial. If you want you can take g to be irreducible, but it does not matter. Then then what you do is you look at a n plus 1. So here is so in a n plus 1 there is one extra coordinate, alright. And well, I am not going to really draw a picture, but I am going to do the following thing. I am going to look at the 0 set of gy minus 1 inside a n plus 1, okay. So what does that mean? That means that I am taking the affine coordinate ring of a n plus 1 to be just k x1 through xn. So I am taking the same n variables plus I am going to add another variable y. So this is now n plus 1 variables, okay. And the way I have written it, since I have put an extra variable, this an is actually sitting as an n dimensional plane inside this n plus 1 dimensional space, which is, so this this an is actually sitting inside this an plus 1, okay. And it is the locus given by y equal to 0. When I put y equal to 0, then I get I cut down by one dimension, okay. And the corresponding sub variety that I get here is actually this an. That is what it means to take these variables to be x1 through xn, okay. And if you look at the polynomial gy minus 1, gy minus 1 is an irreducible polynomial. This is something that you can check. The polynomial gy minus 1 is irreducible, alright. And therefore the ideal that it generates is a prime ideal, alright. The ideal that it generates is a prime ideal, and therefore the 0 set of that ideal is an irreducible closed sub variety, alright. So this certainly is an affine variety. This certainly is an affine variety in this affine space of dimension 1 more, okay. And what is the affine coordinate ring of this affine variety? What is the ring of functions on this affine variety? It is by definition equal to the polynomial ring of the ambient variety divided by the ideal of this variety, the ideal of this closed subset, which is the prime ideal gy minus 1. See, gy minus 1 is an irreducible polynomial, and an irreducible polynomial in a unique factorization domain, an irreducible element in a unique factorization domain always generates a prime ideal. So this ideal is a prime ideal, okay. And now the more beautiful thing is that there is, in fact, you can define a map from here to here which is a bijective map, okay. The map is given as follows. You give me a set of points lambda 1 through lambda n, you give me a set of points here in this open set. So what it means is that a set of points in an is in this open set if and only if g does not vanish at this point. That means if you plug in lambda 1 through lambda n for x1 through xn in g, you should get a non-zero scalar, okay. And you know what you are going to send it to? It is very simple. You are simply going to send it to lambda 1 through lambda n, and the last coordinate will be 1 by g of lambda 1 through lambda n. Send it to this point. Now this point is a point with n plus 1 coordinates. The first n coordinates are just as these n coordinates, okay. And the last coordinate is such that this point satisfies the equation gy minus 1 equal to 0, because the last coordinate y is 1 by g, where g is applied to the first n coordinates, okay. So you can check that this is a bijective map, okay. Already you know, if you take two n tuples like this and they go to the same one there, okay, then they have to be the same here, and every point there corresponds to a point here. You can get the point here by simply forgetting the last coordinate. You restrict to the first n coordinates. So what I am saying is that the map from an plus 1 to an is a projection, projection onto the first n coordinates, okay. And if you project this, you will get DG, okay, you will get DG, that is what is happening. Now you can do a little bit of calculation and show that this map is actually a homeomorphism, okay. You can try that out. You can show that this map is a homeomorphism. The fact is that this map is not just a homeomorphism, it is actually an isomorphism of varieties, okay. But that is a fact that we will have to check later on, because I have still not defined for you what is meant by a morphism of varieties, okay. Because an isomorphism of varieties is an invertible morphism of varieties, it is a morphism of varieties which has an inverse which is also a morphism of varieties, okay. But just grant that for the moment. The fact is that this is an isomorphism of varieties, and the philosophy is once you have an isomorphism of varieties, that should give rise to an isomorphism of the corresponding affine coordinate rings, okay. So if you believe that, it will tell you that the affine coordinate ring of this must be isomorphic to the affine coordinate ring of this. But what is the affine coordinate ring of this? The affine coordinate ring of this is this, okay. But what is this isomorphic to? This is isomorphic to the localization of the polynomial ring in n variables at g. This isomorphism comes from commutative algebra, okay. So if you believe that, it is fair to take the ring of functions on this to be this, which is what our definition was, okay, okay. So what you must understand is that if you believe that these two are isomorphic as varieties, okay, evidence for which is that you can check as an exercise that this bijective map is actually an isomorphism in the topological sense, namely a homeomorphism. Mind you, this DG is a subset of AN, AN has a Zariski topology, this is an open set, so it has an induced topology, okay. And Z of GY minus 1 is a closed subset here, that also has an induced topology, Zariski topology. And I am saying this bijective map is not just a bijective map, it is a homeomorphism, it is continuous in both directions, okay. And that tells you that these two spaces are homeomorphic, but it does not stop there, they are actually isomorphic as varieties. And if they are isomorphic as varieties, they are the philosophy is that their coordinate rings, the rings of functions, have to be isomorphic. Therefore you can, the ring of functions on this has to be isomorphic to the ring of functions on this, which by definition is this, by our earlier definition. But that is isomorphic to this because of commutative algebra, and therefore it is correct in that sense to take the ring of functions on DG to be this, okay. So this is a kind of heuristic argument which involves certain things that need, that will be checked later, okay. So this is some justification as to why you should define it like this. Of course the other justification is where G doesn't vanish, 1 by G and powers of 1 by G will also make sense as functions, and therefore most general functions you can write should be of this form, okay. And I should also tell you that this geometric picture is actually a translation of this commutative algebraic isomorphism, okay. This is the coordinate ring of this, this is the coordinate ring of that, and the fact that these two rings are isomorphic as K algebras is actually a reflection of the fact that these two fellows are isomorphic as varieties, okay. So it is commutative algebra, this is the commutative algebra statement, these two being isomorphic as varieties is the algebraic geometric statement, and they are just, you know, each is equivalent to the other, provided you make the right definitions, alright. So that is to convince you why this definition is correct, okay. Okay, so I will continue trying to tell you about the points that lie here, okay, with respect to the null sans ads, okay. So that that will also give you an idea that this is that that will also give you another justification as to why this is the this should be defined as a ring of functions on DG. Okay, so I will do that in the next lecture.